Assalamu alaikum.
This is the history of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, part 3. We hope you enjoy watching the video. If you like this video, please share and subscribe. Thank you. In 631, the Prophet Muhammad sent 300 Muslims from Medina to perform the Hajj, which is according to the new Islamic way. Abu Bakr was put in charge of the group. The day after Abu Bakr and his group left for Hajj, the 9th chapter of the Quran, Surah Tawbah, was given to the Prophet Muhammad. At the time of this revelation, it was reportedly suggested to the Prophet Muhammad that he needed to inform Abu Bakr. Prophet Muhammad said, only a member of his family could tell people about the revelation. Prophet Muhammad summoned Ali and requested that he proclaim a portion of Surah Tawbah to the people gathered at Mina on the day of the sacrifice. Ali rode out on the Prophet's camel with slit ears and overtook Abu Bakr. When Ali joined the party, Abu Bakr wished to know if he had come to issue or relay orders. Ali said, he didn't come to replace Abu Bakr as Amir al-Hajj. Instead, he came to give the people a message from the Prophet Muhammad. Abu Bakr was in charge of the Hajj ceremony in Mecca, and Prophet Muhammad's message was read by Ali. The main points of the proclamation were: Number 1. Non-Muslims were forbidden from visiting the Kaaba and performing the pilgrimage from that point forward. Number 2. No one may circumambulate the Kaaba without clothing. And Number 3 is, polytheism was not acceptable. Where Muslims had agreements with polytheists, those agreements would be honored for the duration of time specified. Where there were no agreements, a 4-month grace period was granted, after which no concessions were to be made to polytheists. On the day this proclamation was issued, a new era began, and Islam became the sole supreme religion in Arabia. In 632, during the final weeks of the Prophet's life, he ordered an expedition into Syria to avenge the Muslims' defeat in the Battle of Mutah some years earlier. Osama ibn Zayd was in charge of the campaign. His father, Zayd ibn Haritha, Prophet Muhammad's former adopted son, had been killed in the previous battle. Osama's appointment was controversial, because he was young, had no experience, and had never been tested. This became a big problem when he was put in charge of veterans, like Abu Bakr, Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, and Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. Still, the expedition was sent out, but soon after it left, word came that Prophet Muhammad had died, so the army had to go back to Medina. Abu Bakr didn't start the campaign again until he became caliph. When he did, he chose to keep Osama in charge, which led to the campaign's success. Several stories about Prophet Muhammad's last days have been used to show that he and Abu Bakr were close friends, who trusted each other. In one of these times, Prophet Muhammad was getting close to dying and couldn't lead prayers like he usually did. He told Abu Bakr to take his place, even though Aisha was worried that her father was too sensitive to handle the job. Abu Bakr then took over, and when Prophet Muhammad walked into the prayer hall for Fajr prayers, Abu Bakr tried to move out of the way so that Prophet Muhammad could take his usual place and lead. However, Prophet Muhammad allowed him to continue. In a related incident, Prophet Muhammad ascended the pulpit around this time. He addressed the assembly, stating, God has given his servant the choice between this world and that which is with God, and he has chosen the latter. Abu Bakr, realizing that Prophet Muhammad had a short life expectancy, replied, no, we and our children will be your ransom. Prophet Muhammad consoled his friend and ordered that all doors leading to the mosque be closed, with the exception of the door leading from Abu Bakr's home, because I know of no one who is a better friend to me than he. Upon Prophet Muhammad's death, the Muslim community was unprepared for the loss of its leader, and many felt a profound sense of shock. Omar was especially distressed, declaring that Prophet Muhammad had gone to consult with God and would soon return, and threatening anyone who claimed Prophet Muhammad had died. Abu Bakr went back to Medina and showed Umar that Prophet Muhammad was dead by showing him his body. This made Umar feel better. He then addressed those who had gathered at the mosque, saying, if anyone worships Muhammad, Muhammad is dead. If anyone worships God, God is alive and immortal, thus putting an end to any idolizing impulse in the population. He then concluded with verses from the Quran, O Muhammad, verily you will die, and they also will die. Chapter 39, verse 30, and, Muhammad is no more than an apostle, and indeed many apostles have passed away before him. If he dies or is killed, will you then turn back on your heels? And he who turns back on his heels, not the least harm will he do to Allah, and Allah will give reward to those who are grateful. Chapter 3, verse 144. Immediately, following Prophet Muhammad's death, the Ansar, Medina residents, gathered in the Banu Sa'da clan's Saqafah courtyard. At the time, Most people thought the meeting was for the Ansar to choose a new leader of the Muslim community among themselves. The Muhajirin, who had come from Mecca, were not invited. However, this eventually became the subject of debate. Still, when Abu Bakr and Omar heard about the meeting, they were worried about a possible coup and rushed to the event. Abu Bakr warned the men who had gathered that if they tried to choose a leader from a tribe other than Muhammad's, the Quraysh, there would probably be trouble because only they had the community's respect. He then took Omar and Abu Ubaidah by the hand and offered them to the Ansar as potential choices. Habab ibn Mundhir, a veteran of the Battle of Badr, countered with his suggestion that the Quraysh and the Ansar choose a leader from among themselves, who would then rule jointly. The group grew heated upon hearing this proposal and began to argue amongst themselves. With Omar's support, Abu Bakr became the heir to Muhammad's realm. He took the title Khalifatul Rasul, the vicegerent of the Prophet, shortened to Khalifa, Caliph. Thus, he laid the foundation for the Islamic Caliphate. After several months, Ali pledged his allegiance to him. Thank you for watching Part 3, The History of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. We will continue with Part 4. Make sure you share and subscribe to this channel and press the notification button so that you can catch the following video. Thank you and wassalam.